What's up, dogs? I had a question last week about how I was recording, and so I thought I would give a quick rundown of this little studio and the things that I try to avoid when I'm recording my YouTube videos. I'm not doing anything special, and I'm not technically savvy with lighting and sound, so this would be fairly high level. Let's start with the pre-recording work though, because that's more important than the gear or the setup that we have. And my name is Dan Yoshua, I'm a creative entrepreneur, and I hope you have a lovely week ahead. Do not put off the title and thumbnail creation. The very first thing I do for any video is to figure out what my title and thumbnail concept is going to be and figure out how that's going to help me make my overall pitch. For instance, for this video, I knew I could put my super wide lens to good use to snag a pic of me in my natural YouTube habitat. While I don't necessarily create the thumbnail at that point, I do have a solid vision before I even press record. Usually I do go ahead and take that picture and edit it before even starting, and that's what I've done in this case. I'm just starting to record now, but I already have this thumbnail as my overall concept. For me, it serves as motivation to keep cranking on the video, because I'm excited to see how well it performs. I completed final versions of both of these while scripts were still in early drafts, and I was excited to finish up the videos at that point, even though each would still take many hours of work to finish. The title should attempt to create some sort of intrigue. It's pretty difficult in my opinion, but you want to avoid having super lame titles. For instance, when scripting, I titled this How I Make My YouTube Videos, with a bullet point structure of do this, do this, make sure you do this. In my revision to create more mystery, I used the phrasing, what not to do, and adjusted my bullets to be, you know, don't do this, or this, definitely not this, no, stop, don't. And to really nail this point home, at the most abstract level, YouTube videos have two jobs. I just filled up a card. Our sixth life. One, pitch your idea or value. This is done with your title and thumbnail combo, and it's measured in click-through rate. And two, deliver on that pitch. And this is measured in watch time and other viewer signals, like comments and liking. Creating the title thumbnail combo first helps keep you aligned in reaching those two goals and helps you imagine what your viewer will be looking for when they go to click on that video. After and or during my thumbnail creation process, I bang out a little script. I'm not a great writer, and thankfully you don't have to be. Stick to a few main points, then vomit out some deets about each while staying on topic, and more importantly, try to stay helpful. Really imagine the mindset of your target audience that's going to click on your video. You literally should jump into their shoes. Don't forget that your channel isn't about you. It's really about others and helping them or entertaining them while getting to make videos that you like. So even when you're talking about your video process, like I'm doing right now, highlight the things that will be valuable to others. From a scripting perspective, I would say don't stick to it word for word 100%, and don't completely wing it. At the bare minimum, even having a few points in your mind will go a long way toward helping you stay on topic and again, further that objective of delivering value. Also, the more you script colloquially, the more you can just straight up read right from your script while running B-roll over top. No one will be the wiser. Shit. Onto the physical space, here's the studio tour. It's no Peter McKinnon, MKBHD, or Lou Later, but it's pretty damn close. 11 by 14 feet or so. Everything the light touches is from IKEA. Big dining room table is a desk 30 by 60 inches, and one sliding glass door. This is a one bedroom apartment, and this is the sole bedroom. When I repainted, I moved all my shit to the living room and never moved it back. And I didn't because I knew that keeping this as a studio space would allow me a standing desk and a great place to do remote product photography during COVID. And I knew that recording for YouTube could be set up very quickly and it would just speed up my workflow. My advice here is not to worry so much about the space itself or how it looks, but to focus on keeping the barriers to recording low. Function over beauty. Even when I did have everything in here, there was still a 3 by 5 foot space at the end of my bed I could set up very quickly and reliably to do just a talking headshot. Looking at the gear, I'll try to list this in order of what I think is most important. You don't want to use your onboard camera mic, so I think having a microphone is the most important thing. It doesn't have to be killer, but it should be something much better than the built-in camera mic. I use the lav for my talking now, and I plug it right into my phone's voice memo to record. I have a Rode something or other that I use for backup, and I point that directionally at sounds that I need to record. Until you have lights, You can use natural light. It's usually helpful to align close to a window or door, at an angle, and just pretend it's a big softbox. In fact, if you get direct sun, you could even tape white paper or hang a white sheet over top so that you can soften that light coming through. I got some lights long ago when I wanted to be able to film at night after work and to have more consistency. These aren't super strong, but they work. For my main or key light, this is right at the edge of the desk, and it's pointed 45 degrees slightly downward on my face. And then sometimes I don't even use it for a more dramatic look, but usually I light the background wall up with another tilted upwards. That gives it some bounce off the white walls and ceiling to illuminate the room softly in the background, and it works well to fill in the dark side of my face. If you are shooting with an f4 or less, shooting with an artificial light is going to be helpful to get a consistent looking headshot if you don't have a natural light source. I don't have a ton to say on which camera to use for YouTube, except to utter the overused phrase, shoot with what you have at the time. There is a lot more to learn about YouTube than the technical filming or editing process, and a lot of that has to do with story elements, creating that thumbnail, making that pitch, and the most important thing is to get started and to pump out the vids. For reference, if I use the same lighting and pop on a GoPro or a phone, we're looking plenty decent enough to record. Generally, viewers seem more forgiving on the video front than on the audio front. For reference though, most of the videos on my channel thus far have been shot at 1080p on the Canon RP and upscaled to 4K. Some I shot in 4K with the RP, but autofocus and crop in 4K made that difficult to fully trust for focusing. And then recently I started using 4K recording on the R6, and you'll likely notice a big difference in sharpness quality and the way that the autofocus tracks my face extremely reliably. Again, you don't need an R6 for YouTube. I have one for photography. It's how I'm making most of my money in this freelance experiment. I just so happen to use it for YouTube because it's on hand. Finally, I'm sure you could rig something up, or if you're logging, you might not need one right away, but you'll need a tripod as well. I would recommend spending more than $20 here. I just tried to go cheap on a backup, and it's actually unusable. 20 bucks out the window. You also don't have to spend hundreds, though. If you want the tiniest form factor and you're going to carry it around everywhere, you definitely could. And after recording, we finally get to the editing process. I import all of my assets into my editor, and the first thing I do is sync up my main talking head video track audio from the Rode with the lab audio that I've recorded onto my phone. Then I give my good audio a quick edit in Adobe Audition, but you can use anything really. After that, I cut down that extended A-roll clip to only the good stuff in a pretty rough cut, and then I do a second pass to clean up the gaps between each clip. Next, I work in all the B-roll or images that should be overlaid on this talking track. YouTube is about keeping attention, and the first way we can do that is to be helpful, useful, or tell a good story like we discussed earlier, and I'm attempting to do that in my script writing and in my speaking. And the second way is visually, and so that's where B-roll can help break up long speaking tracks. Finally comes the finishing touches like color, sound, music, and titles. I try to correct the colors to the best of my shoddy ability, add in titles and sound, and I pop in a music track from Epidemic Sound, which you should totally try for a month free using my link below in order to support this channel. Just saying. For a video that isn't focused as much on a talking head track, I would consider music much earlier in the process. But for something like this, I'm just looking for tracks that fit the mood, that I can find quickly, and play them softly while I'm speaking. And now that we've covered this little setup, don't get too used to seeing me here. My days in this apartment are numbered. I knew they would be when I transitioned from a full-time data analyst to a freelancer with a runway. Starting April 1st, I'll be talking about that transition on this channel a little bit more. The 4-1 video will be a Q1 review of the transition to freelancing, the state of the channel in terms of growth and monetization, things that I've learned, what's next for me in that quarter, things like that. I'll try to be super transparent. By definition, these quarterly updates will be a little bit selfish, as opposed to explicitly trying to teach or help you do something, but I hope they're valuable for anybody that might consider freelancing moving forward. If you're excited for that one, it would be really, really helpful if you could let me know down below.